When I was a kid, I was a fat kid. Yeah. And when I was a teenager, I was a very, very fat teenager. And of course, when I was 15, with my 110 kilos, I'm not gonna crush this girl, one of the girls in my group of friends, right? She was blonde, blue eyes, with something not very, say, fancy here, but in Spain is kind of unique, right? I was and I decided to try. Give it a try. 15 years old, courageous, why not? So that day, I dress up, I pant, not because I wanted to be pant, because I have big legs. So, anyway, I decided to have a very nice hair dress. Yes, I have hair. And I got ready. This is the moment. So, I prepared it with my friends, so they arranged it to make the two of us to be alone in a specific moment. I told her, I like you. And she was like, you? The fat guy? Oh my God, she ran away. Literally. She ran away. I got so desperate. I said, oh my God. I got so angry. So to me, up to that moment, being fat was not a problem. Okay, it was a problem when I wanted to buy clothes. But the rest of the day was not a problem. But then they became a problem. Because of course, I was 15 years old, I wanted to, intercourses, to be honest, and I didn't see that possible with that impediment, really big impediment. So, well, of course, before that, I tried a lot of diets, a lot, like all of them. Like more protein, more water, eating less time, eating more time. Same stuff. I was actually going to my doctor and she was saying, so why you come here to see, so to let me see how you get fatter and fatter all the time? But that moment with that girl made a change in my life. It was, I finally got a good reason to lose weight. Before it was okay to lose weight, right? So everybody liked to be, better and all that. Yeah. But in that moment, I had a strong reason. I had a sense of urgency. I really needed to change. I really needed to do something to change. And I wanted to be really fast. I want that to be as fast as possible, right? I never thought about the effort needed to make it happen. I was only thinking about the final result. Like myself, being fit, and being able to talk to a girl without being rejected in at least less than 5 seconds. So yeah, I got into a transformation. I got into a transformation, right? I decided to change my nutrition habits. I decided to start doing sports. And it took me not very long actually. In five months, I lost more than 30 kilos. And instead of just being rejected in 5 seconds, I was rejected in 1 hour. It's way better. It's way better, yeah? But I learned a lot about the transformation thing. We all want it to happen fast. We never think about all the effort needed for it to happen. And of course, we want the shortcuts. Of course, everybody wants the shortcuts because you want the result to happen as fast as possible. Yeah. Well, now, in my life as a coach, in these 12 years that I've been working, helping companies improving, on becoming something that they understand is better, I learned that they have exactly the same feeling as they had. Exactly the same feeling. They want something to change, they are more comfortable, they want to become better, and they want it fast. And if you offer them a shortcut, they will take the shortcut. And it's human as in normal. That's one of the reasons that one of the things that I learned. Another thing that I learned is about the purpose, right? With the time, as I grew up, I realized that the purpose of being in a good shape, being healthy, is not to pick up girls, right? Just to be more comfortable with yourself. But as a teenager, of course, you want that only to pick up girls. And it's normal that now, when companies hear about Agile, what they want is to become faster at delivering software. And it's normal. It's human. It's maybe not the right purpose, but it's the purpose. It's the purpose. And we all know that Agile is not for that. Agile is for something totally different. But it's normal that one of the results, which is picking up with girls, being faster at delivering software, it's a very, very strong reason for them to embrace this evolution. It's a purpose. And actually, I have a good news for these customers that they want to deliver software faster. I have a way. I have a way for them to deliver software faster. Yes, it's this. You get all developers drinking like at least a box of this every day, I would deliver software faster. Yeah. Or no. Maybe no. Or a little more nervous. Yeah. Well, so every time they've now heard about this transformation concept, something like this comes to my mind. Like this transformation. Of course, at this moment you expected to be pictures of me when I was fat. That's not going to happen ever. Ever. Not in a million years. Alright? So when these people come to me and they say, we want to go through an agile transformation, I have this bing, red light coming up. And then first thing that comes to my mind is, they will for sure search for shortcuts.
The Spotify belt.
And there are shortcuts. You put this belt, yeah, every day, for 20 minutes, and they will have the arms like this guy. I kind of struggle to see the connection, but I would really like it to be true, right? I would buy the product, right? I would buy the product. And if my favorite consultant comes and tells me, put this belt, you will be fit, I would do it. I would do it, for sure. Because they are going to help me in the transformation. They are going to help being with whoever I want to be. They are the transformers. Of course, the Agile Transformer here did something else. No offense. No offense. But yes, I expect someone else to do the job for me. Absolutely. I pay you, you come here, and you make it change. Yeah, I pay the personal trainer, he works out, and I get fit. or maybe no, yeah. But that's the purpose of outsourcing, I don't have to work. Yeah. So when they go to the customers and they tell them, well, you have to do the effort, they go. So I pay you, so you have to do the effort. But no, you have to do the effort. No, you have to do it. No, you have to do it. Okay, you're fine. Okay, it's okay. I will buy this Spotify belt. All right. So it's true. We should be aware there are such kind of transformers out there. But like, these are my principles. If you don't like them, I have another principle. I can help you transform. Yeah. Okay. So let's put the jokes apart, and I'd like to share with you what is, in my point of view, in my opinion, in my perspective, this is just my perspective, what is happening right now in the industry, right? I think it's important to give a little bit of context of why this is becoming important. And I think this is just the next step in the history of business, right? To go really fast, so before the 18th century, building products was about property. It was about simply being able to define a good way to do things and repeat that practice. and to pass that knowledge from the master to the student. Yeah? We build shoes, we build shorts, we build things. That was the main manufacturing industry at the time. Yeah. In the 18th century, something important happened in the history, which is we invented this. The steam-powered engine. And with that, factories. With the factories, we are giving the possibility to people to buy things that before were too expensive, that they couldn't afford. So we invent the consumer, the mass consumption. We now can buy more things. Yeah? And that is the first industrial revolution. Everything was about productivity, being able to produce more and more. It makes other planets, right? In the 19th century, we have a more strong effect of this. We invent the production chain. Then we make this factory produce goods even more affordable. So even things that people didn't need before, they start to buy. People start to care about products that they didn't care about before, such as a car. Yeah. People start buying more things because they are available. And that's the second industrial revolution, which was about efficiency. So producing more, and also with a reduced cost, with a more reduced cost. So here companies' success was based on the capability to solve engineering problems and being better at engineering problems for efficiency and productivity. I think this made a lot of sense. Remaining years in the history. In the 21st century, the way in which we communicate with each other became different. The way in which we handle information is different. The way in which machines communicate with each other is different. The way in which we handle energy is different. And the way in which we want the product is different. We want products. We want to want any product. We want a product that is customized to my needs. I have more power now as a customer, so the consumption is now more democratic. As a customer, I have now the right to decide. If you're not building what I need, if you're not giving me the service I need, I will fire you. I can destroy you, regardless of the size you have. So, we are creating this third industrial revolution, the prosumer. The consumer also produces information and gives input to the companies, and also to other consumers. We would start in the Apple store, we rate or give comment about the restaurant, we decide what we want, we have more power, and that's the third industrial revolution. It's about customization. It's about customization. So now, the strongest company in the market is not the one who is better at repeating practices, or the one who is better at engineering, but the one who is better at experimenting with products and services and understand better the customer. So the companies that are better are customization, because this is what the market is needed. And this happens now. The industry needs more customization power in companies. So why Agile starts in software? Where is the connection in software? How many of you here work in the software industry? So why? Because I didn't say anything about software so far, right? Well, my hypothesis is that software itself is made to customize the behavior of a machine, of a computer. So software itself is a customization task. So we are in software, the first people we are really struggling to build products because we have to build customized products under engineering practices. And we struggle to do that. It's like we're trying to do a custom-made suits using the practices that they use in the factory where all the suits are the same, like Zara. And it doesn't fit. We are the first one is strongly facing the problem of customization. We are not able to customize. We need to find a different way to interact with the customers so we can customize for them instead of building in a repeatable way for them. Building in a repeatable way works when you are building cars or cell phones in a production, link, but not for customized things. So that's my hypothesis, that's the context of a deal. On top of that, I think that all the companies need different capabilities. All the companies need some standardization, for sure. All the companies have something that they know how to do, they know it works, and they will repeat. And repeating is good, and repeating is needed. All the companies, they have some needs from engineering to understand the problem, reduce the problem, and solve the problems, and find repeatable ways to solve it. All the companies do engineering, all sectors, all domains. All the companies need to experiment with products and services to understand better what the customer buys. All the companies, and this is not new either. And all the companies need to face chaotic situation, unexpected situation. Maybe a social media attack, or a security attack, something, a political crisis, something happened and they need to be able to be resilient for that and come up again and not be destroyed after those problems. So actually I think that we are not discovering anything new with this agility. So all the companies, all the time, need to be able to have some standards, need to be able to do some engineering, need to be able to do some experimentation, and need to do some crisis management. All the companies, in all domains. And some companies need to be stronger at one of this. There are some companies that are, they are successful because they find something that works, and they try to repeat, and they are good at repeating. Yeah. Of course, they also need to be able to do all the rest, but mainly they are good because they are good at solving dominantly obvious problems at standardization. There are some companies that are based their success on their capability to do engineering. Companies that they are good because they do good engineering. They build good products in a repeatable way. And there are some other companies that they succeed because they are better at experimenting and understanding the customer. And of course, there are companies that they succeed because they are able to create environments that are more resilient, or they are able to help systems to recover after big problems. We have different kinds of companies. What is happening is some domains that before had a type of needs. Before, they were successful because they were good at something. Now they need to be good at something else. They need more capabilities in another domain. And this is what is happening. What is happening is some domains, such as banking, requires now more customization to understand your customers. Because other players, they are offering that. It's not that the bank should stop being a bank. It's not that the bank should forget about their standards and their financial engineering, because that's what makes the money happy. It's that banks, for example, they need to be better at understanding the customer. On top of that, on top of the second contextualization of agility, so the need for new capabilities. Yeah. How to make that happen? How are organizations like? So if the visible part, oh, this is in the studies. Sorry. Actually, I did the same keynote in Agile Peru. It was long ago, and it's my apologies. Processes, though. All right. So, the visible part in organizations is the processes. So, what they do. And of course, in what they do, there should be capabilities in each of the things. Yeah? We should have practices to ensure quality and stability. We should have practices to ensure productivity and efficiency. We should have practices to ensure experimentation and learning. Something new for some organizations. We should have practices to ensure resilience and talent growth. Because otherwise, if we miss some of this, the whole system will erode. So if we, for example, decided to scrum, right? Scrum is only useful as a process if it helps me becoming better at all those things. If I do Scrum just because it's nice, just because to do the, you know, the ceremonies, or they have their roles and like that, it's not going to get me there. Because the purpose is wrong. The purpose is to pick up girls. Oh, sorry. Purpose should be something else. So our purpose should be being better at all this, particularly at experimentation and getting resilience. If the process is good, we are in a good track. But it's not enough, because under what we do is how we do it, how we get together to make things happen, right? It should be compatible with what we do. So that's the structure. Better set the geography of the group. So how we relate to each other to make things happen. Of course, we need to ensure that the structure is ready to support the processes that we want to put in place. So if we want to do standards, I think what's better is the patriarchal structure. One person knows the rule, I tell you the rule. That's it. Yeah, because it's just following a set of rules. If we want to be better at engineering, yes, we can split the problem, the big problem, the smaller problems. So we have a pyramid of roles. Makes sense. But if we want to be better at experiments, we need to be able to create networks. People with different specialties, different knowledge, they get together and work to experiment. Like in a laboratory. It's the best way, to get organized to do experimentation. And if what we want is to attract people, attract talent, create talent, nurture talent, and create resilience, communities is the way to go, as we are here. This is the way to go to create such talent and to create talent. So for sure, if we want to make Scrum to happen, you need to build networks. Otherwise, it's not compatible with the refinement result. Under how we do what we do is why we do what we do. The real purpose. And of course, the culture needs to be compatible with the kind of work that we want to do again. So if you want to be compliant with rules, you need more control-oriented culture. If you want to be better at efficiency and productivity, you need to create an achievement culture. If you want to be better at experimentation, you need to create a learning culture. If you want to be better at creating talent, nurturing talent, and attracting talent, you need to create a collaboration-oriented culture. For this, again, I think what we want is to create a learning environment where it's okay to fail as long as you learn from it. So culture, structure, and processes should be compatible and get together towards the final purpose, which is, as we see before, being better in customization. Yeah? So that's my perspective of agility. And that's why I think it's a good idea to forget about agile transformation. In my opinion, it's a little bit of a too aggressive thing. So you go somewhere, you say, you need to transform, you're fat. So it's like, you know, what shape, you get the person that created a specific practice, and you say, you're an idiot sandwich. You're an idiot. Yeah? So that's the third reason why I don't like talking about transformations. Because that can harm people, that we or hurt people, that create something that is actually working. And it makes sense. It makes sense. Also because, you know, you create fear of the unknown. You will be transformed, but you don't know into what will be transformed. maybe the result is not what you really expected, right? So yeah, just trust me, you want to transform to someone. Yeah? So that's the second reason why I don't like talking about transformation. The next reason is about expectations. You know? Sometimes we create expectations on people. You go to this 100-year-old bank full of people that are close to retirement and say, you will be Spotify in 6 months. But first, maybe they don't want that. Second, maybe it's impossible. Right? So that's another reason why I don't like that. And most importantly, and this is this is the title of the conference. Of course, if you buy something, you want the result. And if you don't get the result, and you have to say, I didn't get the result, you would look terrible, right? So what do you do? You fake results. All agile implementations and transformations are successful. All of them. All the companies are doing agile. Whatever it is, yes, we're doing it. We have that. We have agile installed. Yes. Some companies, they call me, it's the actual agile company, install agile in the company. So I go there with 15 floppy disks. And they agile installed. No, it's not. It's not. Now it's CCD. Or in the cloud. So why humble advice? I think it's a good idea to take that word out of our vocabulary. It will get us, it will get our customers to be more calm, also ourselves. Stop talking about this revolution to something unknown. And maybe just talk about evolution towards growing experimentation capabilities that actually they already have. Companies already have experimentation capabilities. Just need to get better. So tomorrow, this is just my only advice. Stop talking about revolution, even though it feels good. And it's necessary to create a movement. It's necessary. At this moment in the history of agility, we're just helping companies evolving and getting better at the future. So that's it. So now, do you have any questions, any doubts, or can we directly go for beers?
My question is, if we go back one slide about growing experimentation capabilities, what if management does not want or doesn't understand why it's important to have it? How do you convince them?
Don't convince them. Don't worry them. If you get someone, you go, imagine, you go walk in the street, you see this fat guy, and you stop him, hey, you are too fat, you should lose weight. But I don't want, no, you have to lose weight. Then his wife owns you, and you, what is going to happen? He's going to sign up for the gym. He will go one day, and after one day, he will say, he's tired, for sure, and he doesn't work. Gym didn't work. Okay. So if they don't want, wait, the moment will come. And that's all. Thank you again, guys.